Hello, and welcome to this presentation by the Foundation for the Education and Research in Neurological Emergencies. This educational lecture is titled Managing Emergency Department Headache Patients, Life-Threatening Headaches and COVID-19 Implications. My name is Edward Sloan. I'm currently Medical Director of the Physician Assistant Studies Program at Dominican University, and I have been an attending physician in emergency medicine at Carle Foundation Hospital. I am Professor Emeritus in the Department of Emergency Medicine at the University of Illinois at Chicago. The content for this lecture comes in large part from the monograph titled Evaluation and Management of Life-Threatening Headaches in the Emergency Department by Dr. Zoda et al. It was published in Emergency Medicine Practice by EB Medicine, February 2019. Please refer to the complete video and audio content for this educational lecture, as well as other individual parts of this lecture via links found at FERNE.org. You may also refer to the initial podcast and a CME option on the EB Medicine website at ebmedicine.net and specifically at the link listed below. Please note the disclaimer listed below. In general, this information is intended to augment and not replace the clinical judgment that guides the management of any individual patient. The next important secondary headache cause to be considered in the emergency department is posterior reversible encephalopathy syndrome, or PRESS. PRESS can occur and present with an acute onset headache. The patient is noted to have significant hypertension. And really what happens and what is the cause of this headache is the loss of autoregulation of the CNS vessels. Normally, across a wide range of blood pressures, the CNS vessels have a maintained blood pressure in those vessels. But with loss of autoregulation, you can have problems related to encephalopathy, altered level of consciousness, visual changes, and seizures as blood pressure in the CNS vessels increases. How do we lower blood pressure? What is the treatment for PRESS? You want to lower blood pressure to a safe range. And what is safe? I would say consider the 185 over 110 blood pressure used for safe administration of TPA as a reasonable number. You should always attempt to treat blood pressure by addressing mean arterial pressure, and you want to lower mean arterial pressure by up to 25%. This is an important point at which we can talk about mean arterial pressure calculation and treatment. Remember that mean arterial pressure is one-third your systolic pressure and two-thirds your diastolic pressure, as we spend two-thirds of our time in diastole. So a patient with a blood pressure of 120 over 90 has a mean arterial pressure of 40 systolic plus 60 diastolic equals 100 millimeters of mercury. A person with a severe high blood pressure of 210 over 135, their mean is 70 from systolic, 90 from diastolic, or 160 millimeters of mercury, quite high. What about that 185 or 110 blood pressure I talked about before that we utilize for safe administration of TPA? That 185 over 110 generates a mean of 62 systolic, 74 diastolic, or a mean of 136 millimeters of mercury. So in other words, a safe mean arterial pressure might be around 130 millimeters of mercury. So let's consider reducing mean arterial pressure by up to 25%. If the mean in a highly hypertensive patient is 160 and you reduce it by 25% or 40 millimeters of mercury, that reduces your mean arterial to 120 millimeters of mercury. And we already said that 130 millimeters of mercury is a reasonable point at which you can reduce blood pressure in that 185 over 110 range. So suffice it to say, a reduction of mean arterial pressure of 15 to 20% may be adequate even in patients with elevated blood pressure and the PRESS syndrome. So as we stated, you can often safely only reduce your mean arterial pressure to a value of approximately 130 millimeters of mercury, similar to about a blood pressure of 180 over 105, with no need to further reduce blood pressure because you've reached a safe mean arterial pressure, especially if the patient's symptoms are improving. So what IV antihypertensives can be used? Nitroglycerin, a venodilator, can be used especially when there's suspected concomitant cardiac ischemia. You can give nitroglycerin at 100 to 200 micrograms per minute, monitoring blood pressure during this treatment. Esmolol, a cardiac beta blocker, can also be utilized when the patient is tachycardic. This can be given at 50 to 200 mics per kilo per minute. And lastly, labetalol, a combination alpha-1 and beta blocker, can be used in tachycardic patients. It can be given by bolus 20 to 40 milligrams every 10 minutes, up to a total of 300 milligrams. There are two other IV antihypertensives that should be mentioned. These are optimized with continuous infusion, especially in patients who are hypertensive and encephalopathic, such as with the Press syndrome, and they are often used in the neurointensive care unit. The first is nicardipine, one of the two calcium channel blockers we're addressing. Nicardipine can be given at 5 to 15 milligrams per hour, starting at a 2 to 5 milligrams per hour range. The other is clavidipine, a calcium channel blocker, 1 to 2 milligrams per hour range, maxing out at 16 milligrams per hour. When considering the diagnosis and treatment of emergency department headache patients, especially in the setting of this current COVID-19 pandemic, the following can be concluded. Emergency department headache patients who present with potential life threats can be identified. In order to do so, a systematic evaluation is critical, and the electronic medical record can help with this process. Most importantly, subarachnoid hemorrhage can be excluded in patients who present with sudden severe headache, given our current diagnostic capabilities. Also to be noted, head and neck infection, CNS infection, and CNS thrombosis must be considered if subarachnoid hemorrhage is excluded as the likely etiology for patients with potentially life-threatening headaches in the emergency department. During the time of this current COVID-19 pandemic, it is possible that common primary etiologies of headache, such as muscle tension headache, migraine, or even headache related to dehydration, can commonly be seen in emergency department patients. However, when considering patients with potentially life-threatening headache in the emergency department, at this time, it is worthwhile to always consider COVID-19 as a potential etiology of these life-threatening headaches. During the time of this COVID-19 pandemic, besides specifically testing for the COVID-19 virus, there's no need to specifically alter our approach to diagnosing and treating patients in the emergency department with life-threatening headaches. If you have any specific questions related to this educational content, please send an email to fern.org@gmail.com. We encourage you also to go to the fern.org website for more content related to this educational program, as well as other content related to the care of patients who present to the emergency department with life-threatening illness and injury related to neurological emergencies. Thank you.